Yes, we've all been waiting to hear. The man who called the crisis. A true son of liberty. Someone who's been hitting the airwaves, hitting the radio waves since 2006 to let everybody know there's a collapse coming. Are they listening to him? Should they be listening to him? Should they have listened to him when he was talking about this? Is this a man who knows what he's talking about? Absolutely. And he's a friend of ours. He's a friend of the United States. His name, Mr. Peter Schiff. He's the president and founder of EuroPAC, Euro Pacific Capital, here to talk to you.
You know, don't believe the propaganda, and that's what it is. When you're listening to an analyst on a lot of these popular financial shows, or the mainstream Wall Street firms, you're not getting investment advice. You're getting propaganda. These firms are trying to sell you stocks. Their real clients, their banking clients, are trying to get rid of stock.
Well, I think that your honesty is a very valuable asset to you, and so long as you just stand true to your word and your beliefs, and you remain steadfast to them, I think there's no way that you could lose.
I think the most successful politicians are the most successful liars. The people who stay in office and who are very successful, like a Chris Dodd, who's been in the Senate for five terms, I think they do that because they tell people what they want to hear, not what they need to hear. I'm not going to lie to win. I'm not going to compromise my principles. I'm not going to try to lie so I can get in office. I mean, either the people are going to elect me because they believe in what I'm saying, or they're going to send another politician back to Washington because they're that's what they want.
Hopefully what happens is Americans have the good sense to do the opposite of what the government is doing and pay back their debts that they already have. We don't need more spending. That's how we got into this mess. We borrowed money that we didn't have, and we spent it on things we didn't need and we didn't make.
Peter, you have been mocked on all of these financial shows going back to 2005.
Oh my gosh.
Going back to 2005. And not only did you predict problems, you actually explained what was going to happen. Why didn't anybody listen? You were Cassandra.
They think our problems are behind us. They're not. The bulk of the problems are still in front of us. We're still in a bear market, and these stimulus checks aren't going to change it. Who's laughing?
Okay, well, you know,
I am. At you. Yeah.
First of all, I have no idea what Peter Schiff is talking about. So what artificial lending standard are you talking about?
Well, most of the profits that people have in real estate are going to vanish, just like the profits in the dot-coms in 1999-2000. It's a fantasy. People can't sell their house. The inventories are exploding all over the country. Houses are on the market for 6 months a year. There's no bidders.
So,
the price is going to fall through the floor. You guys are deluding yourself.
We heard it.
6 months average.
We heard.
You know, I've been forecasting the bankruptcy of these two companies for years. It would be much better to let them fail. I don't want the government to nationalize it. I don't want the government to have anything to do with mortgages or housing. What would happen?
They already do.
But get them out of it.
How?
They never should have been there.
How?
You know, these two agencies were put in place theoretically to make housing more affordable. Instead, they did the opposite. By encouraging too much credit and too much easy money going into housing, they enabled housing prices to be bid up. So now you have a lot of Americans who own homes, but they've bankrupted themselves in the process. They have huge mortgages. What would happen if Fannie and Freddie were out of the picture? And Americans had to go to banks and borrow money to buy houses. Given our limited supply of savings, interest rates would be very high. And home prices would be very low. And so people could buy houses because even though they would pay higher interest payments, they would have very low prices. And people wouldn't have to go into debt up their eyeballs to buy a house.
Joining us now in a first on CNBC to tell us what he thinks about the government plan to back up battered mortgage giants Fannie and Freddie, Barney Frank, chairman of the House Financial Services Committee. Mr. Frank, let's begin with the Fannie and Freddie news. What information do you have about the status of those institutions and their need to access the window open to them yesterday?
I don't think they have a need to access the window. I think it is important that people know that the window was there. I think this is a case where Fannie and Freddie are fundamentally sound, that they are not in danger of going under.
First of all, these institutions are fundamentally, speaking of the GSEs, are fundamentally sound and strong. Secondly, as Chairman Bernanke has pointed out, they are adequately capitalized. In fact, they're holding capital in excess today of what's currently required by federal law.
Why do you think that a recession is coming, and just how bad is it going to be?
I think it's going to be pretty bad, and whether it starts in 07 or 08, I think, is immaterial. And I also think it's going to last not just for quarters, but for years.
I think Peter is just totally off base, and I don't think it's going to be, I mean, I just don't know where he's getting his stuff.
The savings rate doesn't mention. One of us is off base, but it's definitely not me.
Peter, I'm going to take a bet with you on this one. I'll bet you a penny on this one that if you'll sign a letter saying that if you're wrong, you'll sign a letter that you were wrong to me in this, but you're just way off base. There is nothing out there that tells us we're going to have a nice slowdown, but it's not going to be a
crash. All right, let me ask you this.
I'll bet you a lot more than a penny.
The subprime problem is a problem, but it's a tiny problem in the context of this economy.
This is just getting started. It's not just subprime. You know, this is a problem for the entire mortgage industry.
Was they try to criticize me for saying that the recession is the cure, not the problem, as if I'm happy about the recession, as if I want a recession. I don't want recessions. And the way not to have recessions is not to have the government create all the problems that makes recessions necessary. But once the problems are there, once you inflate the bubble, it has to burst. This is the bad tasting medicine that we have to take.
But whoever thinks this is a two-person race, obviously, if they saw the enthusiasm of the people in this room, they know that there is a third candidate in the race. And actually, I think I'm the strongest candidate of the three. Yeah! So we got a lot of people already volunteering, but we can use a lot more. And I think that is going to be one of the real weapons that I have that my opponents don't have. Because there's nothing that Linda McMahon is doing or that Rob Simmons is doing that's going to inspire anybody. You know, they're going to have to pay people to work for them because they don't stand for anything. But I've got a lot of people, you know, who believe in what I'm trying to do, who believe in liberty, who believe in the Constitution, Woo! Who believe in capitalism. Yeah. The Republican is giving those things a bad name. You know, the Republican brand has been tarnished by people who have pretended to be Republicans, but who have governed like liberal Democrats.
Yeah.
And we're fed up with it. I'm not running to be a senator and get along with everybody and be a career politician. I couldn't care less if everyone in the Senate hates me. I'm not going to kiss butt and get on the right committee. You know, I'm going to try to get there to hold these guys accountable for what they've done and try to get them to understand that document that they swore to uphold when they took their oath of office as a constitution and get them to understand exactly what it says and what it means and get them to understand that the source of our problems is in Washington and they're not going to solve them by making them worse. We don't need more government, we need less government. And hopefully, if I get in there, that maybe there are some Republicans that really share our values, but they're too afraid to speak up. Maybe I can energize them. Maybe I can encourage them to actually act on their principles and actually put the nation ahead of their own political careers and be willing to take a stance that might be unpopular, but it's what we need to do.
There is real support for my candidacy. If people who really believe in freedom and liberty and sound money and the Constitution, if they're prepared to support that with an actual political contribution, if they're prepared to volunteer their services and work on his campaign, other than going to government to put a stop to everything that they're doing and to try to restore sanity to an insane Congress and try to be a roadblock. You know, I'm not there to get reelected, so they can't bribe me. They can't find a way to try to promise me something to quiet me down. They won't be able to control me. They'll never have seen a senator like me because I won't be like any other senator. I'm there to do a job, and I'm there to leave. And I'm not going to be a politician. And is there a support for that kind of candidate? We'll see. Because nobody can tell the truth. No one can tell the public reality. Everybody wants to sugarcoat it. Everybody wants to play Santa Claus. Nobody wants to level with the American public. That's what I'm going to do.